Negron, Francis Negron, is a filmmaker, writer, and scholar. And, welcome, Francis.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Jorge, and the aluCine Festival for inviting me. Originally, you know, when Jorge approached me with the proposition of doing this talk, we had settled that I was going to talk about recent work that I had done about this period on the Young Lords as a way to contextualize the work of José Soltero in a Puerto Rican context, because all the existing work about Soltero is on his queer context, so there's really nothing about the Latino context yet. But I don't know, I mean, well, as we go along, I don't know how familiar you are with Puerto Rican New York. A little bit. So as we get there, we'll be filling in some gaps. And the Young Lords was an organization that kind of came out publicly in July of 1969. And the idea was that through commenting the Young Lords, we would get the Puerto Rican context for Soltero. But before I kind of settled on that idea, I started looking at his work, and I found something remarkable that actually nobody had explored before, which is that Soltero had actually supposedly, and I'll say why supposedly later, had made three films for the Young Lords. And in that regard, it was remarkable because this then was a person, a rare person, that had brought together the queer underground and the Latino underground together. And to just give you a sense of how big the contrast between the two undergrounds are, let me show you an emblematic picture of the queer Latino underground. This is Mario Montes from the film that we saw yesterday, right? Lupe. And the next is the Young Lords. So if you compare the two vanguards, these were the two Latino vanguards at the time, the artistic vanguard and the political vanguard. So these two have been, you know, studied totally separately. So I wanted then today to kind of see how these two came together in the work of Rodriguez and what that could tell you about the avant-garde itself. As you might know and have read many places, Rodriguez Soltero's most known works are experimental films that have a lot of engagement with European, American, and Latin American avant-gardes. Understanding avant-garde to mean, you know, the production of artistic practices interested in conceiving new ways of life. I mean, at least that's the way that I'm looking at it. His first film is called El Pecado Original from 1964. Which is a tribute to a surrealist master, Luis Buñuel, who was shot at the University of Puerto Rico when he was a student. A year later, 1965, Soltero moves to the United States and makes Jerobi, which we saw last night, some of us, which is a silent 10-minute film study of a young man, eventually masturbating. And Lupe from 1966, restating of the life and times of the so-called Mexican spitfire, Lupe Velez. These films are generally seen as the Euro-Latin American avant-garde. That's pretty much the context that they're looking at. But by 1969, Soltero starts making films not avant-garde films, but films about the Latino avant-garde, which is the Young Lords. So now I'll say a little bit about the Young Lords party. The Young Lords were originally a street gang in Chicago. And what happened basically was that the leader of the street gang, Jose Chacha Jimenez, was arrested for a petty crime. While he was in jail, he was converted, I guess, politically converted, by contact with the Black Panthers. So when he came out from jail, he organized his gang, which had been a turf gang, a street gang, into a political organization. When news started to travel throughout Latino communities, particularly the Northeast originally, that there was this organization of Puerto Ricans that were modeling themselves to some extent on the Black Panthers, then other Young Lords chapters were organized, and New York was one of those. However, the Young Lords from New York were quite different from the Young Lords from Chicago. Whereas the Young Lords from Chicago had roots in the street gang, the Young Lords from New York were actually, at least at the top of the Young Lords, were mostly young college dropouts. So they all had some degree of education. And unlike the Young Lords from Chicago, the Young Lords from New York made their image a very important project of their political activism. So it seems that partly responding to the huge visibility that the Young Lords had in New York during this period, he started making these Young Lords bulletins, 1, 2, and 3, and then a year later, he made a film called Despierta Boricua in 1970 on Puerto Rico's status question. And this is an image according to Ronald Peña, who's an artist and star of Diálogos with Che, which was the film that I would consider the transition between the avant-garde, aesthetic avant-garde, and the political avant-garde, Rodriguez Otero's attention to Puerto Rico's status was due partly out of the U.S. domestic context. We have to remember the moment. I mean, this is a moment of great upheaval in the U.S. You're talking about the Vietnam War demonstrations. You have the emergence of all the modern identity movements and so forth. And of course, ethnic groups organizing massively for the first time under this new context was in part due when José Rodríguez Ortega would travel abroad, traveled abroad with his earlier films. He would constantly be asked about what he think about the Puerto Rican question. And it, not coincidentally, in 1970, participated in a mass protest, one of the biggest protests in the U.S. to the United Nations around the Puerto Rico colonization problem. So Peña said that when we go to Paris, we go to Godard, or we go to Berlin, I mean Brecht, José would always be asked, what do you think about Puerto Rico's colonial problem? Now, I don't know how familiar you are with Puerto Rico's colonial problem, so I'll just do a Puerto Rico 101. As we know, Puerto Rico is unincorporated territory of the U.S. since 1898, which basically, in American Supreme Court parlance, means that the territory belongs to, but it's not part of the United States. And the nature of the status, basically, yeah, the way and the reason it was set up that way is to avoid that Puerto Rico, as other territories, including Guam, and the Virgin Islands, American Samoa has a slightly different status, but they're an unorganized territory, would never become parts of the United States. So this is like a limbo status that concedes for the people that live there to have citizenship, but you cannot vote for president of the United States and you cannot have a voting representation in Congress. So as a result of kind of U.S. interventions in the Puerto Rican economy for the first four decades of the time, you know, since 1898, when World War II comes, there's huge pressure on the United States to decolonize Puerto Rico. And the response was basically to give Puerto Ricans a degree of self-government. So now you can elect your own governor, although you can't only elect the president. But with that plan to make Puerto Rico more acceptable to the world, also came a mass migration plan. The idea was, at the time, Puerto Rico was considered one of the poorest countries in the hemisphere, so it was very embarrassing for the United States to be the wealthiest country in the world and have one of the poorest colonies in the world. So what they did was, collaborating with the local elite, they designed this plan pretty much to export hundreds of thousands of people out of Puerto Rico so that Puerto Rico could create a middle class and then remove the stigma and the embarrassment of being such a poor place. And that's the root of the contemporary Puerto Rican population of New York and the United States more broadly. Most people went to New York, so in a few decades' time, there were almost a million people from Puerto Rico in New York City. What's that? Hold on. So that Rodriguez would be interested in the Young Lords should not be surprising. On the one hand, from the beginning of his career, he had a strong interest in Puerto Rican politics. For instance, El Pecado Original, which is generally just thought about as this formal exercise, was also about the status quo of Puerto Rico. And in 1965, Rodriguez Ortero also produced a feature-length film titled Ramón y Mirna, which is described in a piece of paper, basically, at the Filmmakers Cooperative from 1965 as a Puerto Rican drama shot in New York City. On the other hand, his turn to the Young Lords and the United Nations could have constituted a desire to fulfill the avant-garde's goal of transforming social practice and blurring the boundaries between art and political life. Yet, despite the fact that Rodriguez Ortero seems to have made an equal number of underground and above-ground films, there has been no critical engagement with the second part of his production. Part of this has to do with the fact that while his turn towards left politics was a defining and, I believe, a definitive moment in his trajectory, the director seems not to only discourage research about the later productions, but perhaps even destroy the films. While some of his peers, like M.M. Serra, and I believe you're seeing a film of hers in the festival, dismisses the possibility that Rodriguez would have purposely ruined the films, Ron Gregg, who's a film critic who's written one of the pieces on him, said that when he asked Rodriguez Ortero about these political films shortly before his death, which happened this year, last May 22, the director dismissed them by saying that they were not worth looking at. Consistently, Rodriguez Ortero seemed to have done pretty much everything he could for people not to see these films. Queries to Filmmakers Cooperative, Anthology Film Archives, and the United Nations itself have yielded exactly nothing. Everybody says that they have never seen these films, never heard of these films, and so forth. So right now, at least, I would have to say that these films are lost. But despite the fact that the films are, at least for now, lost, Rodriguez Ortero's very harsh assessment raises to me many questions. On the one hand, several of Rodriguez Ortero's surviving works were determined by many to be not worth looking at. Jerobi, for instance, was censored at the 1965 Ann Arbor Film Festival for being pornographic. Pornographic, exactly the word used. In the words of filmmaker Gregory Markopoulos, I learned that certain films had not been admitted to the festival because Mr. Mapunelli's selection committee thought them unworthy of inclusion. Among these were José Sortero's Jerobi. A part of the selection committee ran Jerobi and they were visibly shaken. One young woman immediately proclaimed it pornographic. His infamous LBJ performance, in which Rodriguez Ortero set fire to an American flag with the pro-military song The Ballad of the Green Beret as a soundtrack, provoked the temporary shutdown of the Bridge Theater on St. Mark's Place, a downtown venue. According to conservative journalist Victor Lasky, although some applauded wildly, people screamed, "Throw him out." A horrified onlooker described him as a pinko and a fag. Even recent and sympathetic commentary by Jay Harberman in The Village Voice, situated light years away from the volatile 1960s and its censors, considers Rodriguez Ortero's films as more artifacts than art, state, and a mess. To suggest then that the Young Lords films were not worth looking at also points to an intriguing paradox where the Young Lords represented the most formidable example of a group of Puerto Ricans who people loved to look at. During their heyday as the most visible Latino organization of New York from roughly 1969 to 1972, the Young Lords invested considerable energies in producing an entirely new image for Puerto Ricans, an image that I have called elsewhere the look of sovereignty, and that was meant to replace perceptions of Puerto Ricans as politically passive with an image of Puerto Ricans as tough and inventive defenders of their rights as citizens. In addition, the Young Lords actually had three photographers following their whole career, their public career, among them Michael Abramson, Iram Maristany, and Catherine Orsillo. And the first two, Abramson and Maristany, really worked very hard to produce a larger-than-life image for the Young Lords. In addition, the Young Lords actually had three photographers following their whole career, their public career, among them Michael Abramson, Iram Maristany, and Catherine Orsillo. And the first two, Abramson and Maristany, really worked very hard to produce a larger-than-life image for the Young Lords. So the idea that the Young Lords were not worth looking at, and after the making of these later films, Rodriguez Ortero stopped making films altogether, suggest a possible incongruence between the aesthetic body and the political body, that they may have resulted in the radical spoiling of the image as a site of pleasure and political identification for Puerto Ricans in the underground. It's in fact stunning that the three main figures of the Puerto Rican queer avant-garde, which are Rodriguez Ortero, Mario Montes, and Holly Woodland, Holly Woodland. vanished from public view by the early 1970s, while the top figures of the Young Lords, subjects of infinite number of artistic and mass-mediated images, stayed in the limelight for decades. What made the visual record of the political avant-garde a site of continued pleasure, memory, and even nostalgia for the people that participated? While the aesthetic avant-garde produced, it seems, shame in its Latino protagonist and a desire to no longer want to be seen. Did the hardening of a combative Latino identity make the queer Latino identity being produced by the underground just impossible? So here I want to explore a little bit of what these two avant-gardes had in common, and then a little bit of what they did not have in common. So one way to start to engage with these questions is to think about how the two avant-gardes look at the body itself. Despite the great differences in visual strategies between Rodriguez Ortero and the Young Lords, both focused most of their attention at visualizing the body. In Rodriguez Ortero's preserved works like Jerobi, the racialized queer body is there to be seen and to establish a new relationship between embodied spectator and the queer male body. It's significant that unlike all other prior experimental filmmakers, including Cocteau, Harrington, Miller, Mass, among others, Jerobi is not about exploring the inner self. I mean, you'll see a lot of representations of what's going on in your mind in these other films, but rather how desire is seen and embodied. How can it be literally see what's going on in the surface? Defying the state and the gay bashers alike, Jerobi is about occupying public space, not exploring internal space. Jerobi images, yeah. So that's one kind of still from the film, and this is a close-up of the main character. In this, as Tom Gunnan has written, the avant-garde is connected to the pre-1907 cinema of attractions, in which cinema's power was the harnessing of visibility, the act of showing and exhibition. The avant-garde cinema, as exemplified by another of Rodriguez Ortero's films, Lupe, is also indebted to an exhibitionistic type of popular culture, more interested in the direct stimulation of the spectator than plot-driven type of storytelling. The Young Lords' political strategies were also heavily invested in visibility. Part of this had to do with stylizing the Puerto Rican body itself, The larger dynamics of why the Puerto Rican body was so problematic at this time is that it was mostly represented to stereotypes of violence, gangs, and the like, that had been widely popularized by West Side Story. This is kind of the image that the Young Lords were trying to restyle. And it's interesting that the first political activity that the Young Lords did in New York was called the Garbage Offensive. And they picked garbage as a something to do because basically the city did not provide any services to the Puerto Rican community, including not picking up the garbage. So one day what they did was they picked up a lot of garbage, they put it in piles, and then they set fire to it. When they set fire to it, then everybody had to respond because it became a public hazard, right? But what's interesting about why they picked garbage was that on the one hand it was a big community problem, but at the same time, they said it was also visible. It has often been said that this garbage offensive actually changed the relationship between Puerto Ricans and New York City, but throwing the garbage back in their face and suggesting that Puerto Ricans themselves were not the garbage, but the city's treatment of Puerto Ricans was what was garbage. Both the queer underground and the Young Lords were fascinated by the body's performativity and their capacity to signify liberation from various forms of social control. But while the queer underground developed a layered visual style that continuously transgressed the boundaries of sexual and gender norms, the Young Lords created a storyline in which they could be the protagonist. And they developed So this is kind of Mario Montes with a veil in the film we saw last night, Lupe, which I think emblematic of what I'm talking about, the body as perceived in layers. While the Young Lords' strategy to combat these stereotypes was actually to develop a storyline which hovered around a kidnapping of a building. So I would say that the Young Lords' strategy was twofold. The first thing that they did was they changed the way Puerto Ricans looked. if Puerto Ricans were considered to be politically passive, then they dressed them up as guerrillas, basically, so they could communicate that we mean business, that we're gonna, you know, we're gonna be respected, and that we are sovereign and ready to take control of our political destiny. And the second thing they did after they styled the body in that manner was that they developed a storyline that was very, very attractive to the media. And the storyline was basically that they took over a building or a public, I'll describe some of the actions that they did, or a public property like a truck, and they would hold it hostage until the city would do what they were asking the city to do. So a great example of that hostage crisis plotline is one day that they took over an X-ray truck. They already knew, I mean, they already knew that from their own work. They went house to house through the community. They already knew that people in the community had high levels of tuberculosis, particularly children, and they also knew that there was asbestos, and there was also knew that there was lead paint, because they had done their own independent studies. The city parked this truck in a place where they considered that was not very effective. So one day they took over the truck and moved it to what they thought would be more effective. And the two people that were manning that truck, the technicians, they had to make sure that they stayed on board so they could perform the job. And that's what they did. They moved the truck, and that day they saw 300 more people than in the other location and made their point. So in that regard, while the Soltero's first films are not interested in plot so much as they're interested in texture, they're more interested in being there than they're interested in acting. The young lords who did not have, and I think I should, to be fair, different from the queer underground, the young lords did not have access to the means of representation. It's interesting that there's a class difference between the queer underground and the young lords. Although the young lords were already somewhat upper mobile, Soltero, for instance, came from Puerto Rico, already had college, came from a middle class background, and so forth. So they had more access, more cultural capital to represent themselves and their interests, while the young lords did not. So they had to rely on the mass media to cover them. And in having to rely on the mass media to cover them, they had to then conform to some extent to plot lines and storylines that the mass media would be interested in covering. So the hostage crisis was great because it has drama, and because the hostage crisis was not about taking actual people hostage, but rather taking things hostage. Nobody was gonna die. And I guess the thing I omitted to say earlier is that the young lord's average age was 16 years old, with the top cadres being from 18 to 20. So basically these were teenagers doing this. So you had a bunch of teenagers that had identified what the social problems of the day were not only telling the city what to do, but actually doing what had to be done. So although many times they were arrested, they were never tried and never convicted for anything because popular opinion was always on their side. So the idea was then of these actions was to make the point, one, that there was problems and there were solutions to the problems that were not that hard, there was no rocket science, and on the other hand, to show that Puerto Ricans were not politically passive and they were ready to be part and wanted to be recognized as part and parcel of New York City. Now, lastly, both avant-gardes were very interested in challenging institutions, including those involved in producing, assessing, and disseminating stereotypical images. But as I mentioned, while the avant-garde critiqued the idea that artistic excellence was inherent in a work of art and hence universal, the political avant-garde sought to challenge the idea that specific populations, in this case Latinos, were inherently low in relationship to other groups because of their own cultural limitations, not because of institutional limitations. As Ron Gregg has said in relation to Jerovi, this narcissus, Jerovi, comes right out of the evolving sexual revolution of the 1960s, embracing the sexual pleasure of self without shame or inhibition. This narcissus is clearly liberated and not in the least bit interested in therapy. So both were kind of addressing, stereotypes, and both were addressing race in some ways, but by very different strategic or rhetorical ways. So last section I want to talk about is about the way that both avant-gardes articulated the issue of what liberation is. And I think here is that they, that although they had a lot of things in common, they actually diverged quite a lot in their representational practice and the impact. For Rodriguez Ortero, the new body that had to be produced was sometimes naked, but most often layered, self-consciously produced by myth. In this world, liberation is possible via two paths. One, through narcissistic bodily pleasure, as seen in Jirobi. And two, through transcendental fame, as in Lupe, when actress Lupe's death is ultimately understood as a form of freedom as she ascends into the spirit world, you know? And I, something that I that didn't come up yesterday, but I wanted to say today, that we have to understand Lupe in the context of other stories about Lupe that were told during the day, like both Kenneth Anger and Andy Warhol had made films that referenced Lupe Vélez's life. And what was different from Solteros, from those two films, is that in the other films, Lupe's life is seen as a tragedy. So she killed herself, and it's a tragic occurrence. In Soltero's view, Lupe's life is not a tragedy, even if there was tragedy in it. And that's a very big difference in representation. The Young Lord's articulation of liberation required multiple attention to the body, including, and this is something that runs through all their political work, breakfast programs, clothing, education, and protecting people from disease. However, their dramatic persona, so to speak, was very indebted to conventional storytelling based on the hero, which is something that is, you know, and not only a hero, but a very masculine, a masculinized hero as well. Sure. Now, I probably, I mean, didn't have a chance to explain all the parts about the Young Lord's visual strategies. But here is one of the rare Young Lord's pictures that they actually have. Somebody has a gun. And I look at the gun in the Young Lord's as an accessory rather than an actual thing to kill people. And the reason is that the Young Lord's actually never use guns at any point except for show in some ways. And the reason that the gun was not necessary in this particular action was because there was a Young Lord's, they thought it was necessary, there was a Young Lord that was either killed himself or was killed in prison. And they held a vigil for him at the church they took for the first time. And they brought the guns to say, to communicate to the public through these images that they were not going to accept that their members be killed by the police. But what was interesting about the action was that they had no intent of using the guns. So what they did is they broke the guns down and put it in the purses of the old women as they were leaving the church. And that avoided any kind of confrontation and any kind of arrest for them. So in pointing to the Young Lord's visual imagination or the limitations thereof compared to the queer underground, again, this is kind of what they had to rely on, which was other people's photographs of them and the mass media. So in that regard, and they were very aware, actually, of the limitations of their strategies. For instance, Yoruba Guzman, who was their Minister of Information, was very aware of the limitations of it all by saying the media has to be used because until we have the daily news and we have a TV station and we have a radio station, you know, we have to get to the people and this is the way to do it. There was no other way. Significantly, as Rodriguez Sotero's attempt to move away from his queer subjects and embrace this new, more normative, masculine articulation of a Latino male subject, his film production falters and ends. Although the Young Lords pride themselves in having had a gay caucus, in fact, it was probably the only nationalist organization of the period in the United States to have a gay caucus, a men's conscience and racing group and a feminist group, these other public sovereign selves are never really displayed for public record. So although they have gay members and they had prominent female members, they all had to, in some ways, were in dialogue with this militarized image, which is, you know, a masculinized image to some extent. Rodriguez Ortero's transition film between avant-garde, which is Dialogue with Che, which we didn't see, which is from 1968, perhaps already suggests that it will not be possible to produce a liberated queer Latino subject through purely visual strategies. Perhaps more importantly, the fascination with Che Guevara anticipates a failure for both avant-gardes. For Rodriguez Ortero, the failure may be double. On the one hand, he seemed unable to fit a queer body into a left revolutionary script. On the other hand, the move to identity politics that followed both avant-garde produced shame for Rodriguez Ortero, not as a Puerto Rican, but as an artist. In the words of critic Juan Antonio Suarez, José was always dismissive of his own work. He stopped making films in the early 1970s, and in doing so, seemed to close the door on his life as an artist forever. At the end, the aesthetic avant-gardists failed in their goal of blurring the boundaries between art and life and creating new social worlds. The political avant-gardists also failed in their quest to completely revolutionize society and bring independence to Puerto Rico. But while both avant-gardes must cope with the failure and unsustainability of their projects, it's interesting that the young lord's top command transformed the failure of the image, ushering a revolution, into highly effective upward mobility strategies. In other words, whereas the avant-garde's people, with at least the Latino avant-garde, all kind of disappeared from the scene and didn't really experience upward mobility, most of the young lords, particularly at the top of the leadership ladder, all experienced substantial upward mobility. It's interesting that the law and the media were the two areas that the young lords fought against the most institutionally, and most of the young lords are lawyers, judges, community organizers, and journalists in TV and in print. So it seems that to bring up the question of the chaotic, layered understanding of the body as a site of pleasure of the avant-garde versus the disciplined body that you have to feed, that you have to educate, that you have to conform in some ways to be able to fit in, won that battle, you know. So the transformation of the docile body into a combative body that could then claim its space seemed to have won. And for instance, there's this year was the 40th anniversary of the Young Lords, and there was a massive celebration in the church that they took, for the first church they took the first time. And that is a big contrast to how we remember the avant-garde and who remembers the avant-garde, the Latino avant-garde. Yet the failures and contradictions of the avant-garde should not completely overshadow some successes. The avant-garde did revolutionize thinking about art, although maybe not about social life more generally, and the political avant-garde thinking about race and power. Both contributed to challenging the idea of a timeless, universal, steeped in Eurocentric conceptions of history. The radical need to critique consumer culture, unhinge the self from narrative cliches, and attempt to show something else may be some of the ways that the 70s avant-garde still are with us today in our thinking. But lastly, I would like to comment that despite the fact that in some ways the political avant-garde managed to enact more structural change than the aesthetic avant-garde, the current interest in the works of Jack Smith, I don't know if you're aware, there's a film that came out about 2 years ago, José Rodríguez, by virtue of the gathering that we have here today, and Mario Montes, has to do with the contemporary impossibility of political avant-gardes and the rejection of young activists to this notion itself of a small group of highly skilled soldiers exploring the terrain ahead and leading us. In fact, among Puerto Rican activists today, including a student collective in Puerto Rico called Boricua Pop, had issued a statement recently that says, without God, without master, without motherland, without state, without leaders, without vanguards, without followers, just a non-determined mass of people, which seems a lot closer to the aesthetic avant-garde's idea of people than the political avant-garde's idea of people. So this roaming, chaotic, intermediate subject, uninterested in issues of identity produced by the Latino queer avant-garde, may have anticipated subjective modes and ways of thinking about the self that are now the basis of new activism. At the same time as Boricua's favorite genre of communication, which is the manifesto, which is couldn't be more steep in the history of the political avant-garde, suggests that today's political groups are both enabled and burdened by both avant-gardes. So although lost between vanguards, Rodriguez Ortero's works are not only worth seeing, I believe, but also worth talking about. And that's Mario Montes. Thank you so much. So I guess the best part is now. Is there any questions or comments or anything that I can expand on? Yeah.
Yeah, I have kind of a question or comment because there is three Puerto Ricans who I actually have known, Rafael Ortiz.
Montañez Ortiz, right.
Yeah, Montañez Ortiz, who was also invisible for a long time.
Yeah.
But I think they did a retrospective at the Whitney Museum.
Yes.
He used to do performances and break the piano with the axe and joke like, well, cowboy in the captain of these people.
Sure.
In the air, and like, you know, and play the piano.
Right.
With the axe.
Yes.
And Pedro Pietri, who died for a long time, and
right.
He decided to revive himself in the 90s.
Right.
And so, Pedro, is it any perspective on omission, systemic omission, why had it disappeared? Why, you know, what is it?
Well, there's a lot of things there. Hold on.
Yeah.
On Rafael Montañez Ortiz, he's slightly older,
yeah.
So he starts his work in the late 50s, and he's part of the destructionist movement, right? Which is another type of avant-garde. In fact, I mean, it's phenomenal, the work that he did. I mean, he was pretty much the lone Latino within that context. And some of the works that you can see on the internet, if you like, this was a guy, one of the things that's very striking about him is this is a very tall man. He's like 6'3", I mean, he's a tall guy. And he used to be the axe man. You know, he would wear a suit and he would have an axe. And he would walk to the piano and destroy it, right? And make music that way, or kind of. And what's interesting seeing those pictures to me is that this was probably the only Puerto Rican with an axe in New York City that wasn't arrested. the artistic context kind of gave him that possibility. And yes, it took a very long time for his work to be claimed. And part of that is that the history of the avant-garde are racialized white. Even when there are Latinos in it. Like, I think I was the first person to write about Hollywoodland, like exclusively a whole chapter about Hollywoodland in 2004. And Soltero's two works are still kind of placing him in the queer context. There's still not broader work about him. So part of it, I think, is the way that the avant-garde, that art, and politics are racialized. You know, the art, the avant-garde is for white artists, and that the you know, other people didn't participate in the avant-garde, or if they are noted, they're always footnotes to the real artists. And in fact, I have an ongoing problem with the scholarship on Mario Montes, for instance, despite the fact that there is some people that speak highly of him. He's always seen in a certain there's some pity to the figure of Mario Montes that mediates that work too. But then there was a second part to the. Was there a second part to your question?
No, just
Pedro Pietri. Of course, the New Yorican poets would have been another context that we could explore. But I wouldn't so much maybe call the Puerto Rican, the New Yorican poet movement an avant-garde the same way that the queer avant-garde was one and the Young Lords were one, although there were intersections between the Young Lords and the New Yorican writers. Felipe Luciano was chairman of the Young Lords, was a poet, and the first time that Pedro Pietri gave his famous, presented his famous poem, Puerto Rican Obituary, was at the Young Lord's taking of the church the first time. So there was obviously connections between the two. And what was linking the two was the pursuit, in the case of the Young Lords, of a certain kind of political language and image, and in the case of the poets, a new language to talk about Puerto Ricans in the city. So that those two projects of inventing a people, and that's where the notion itself of New Yorican comes out. Because before, you only had two options. You either were Puerto Rican, that had references in the island, or you were American. That, to some extent, meant giving up being Latino, or giving up your roots, assimilating. I mean, I don't know, in the United States, you pretty much have one option, culturally, it's like to assimilate. So the New Yorican space kind of questioned that binary and said that you could be American or New Yorker, which is different from American. You could be a New Yorker and a Puerto Rican, and you didn't have to choose, and you don't have to forget, and you didn't have to assimilate. So it was a whole new cultural space that was being produced.
One more comment that I think I made to you yesterday, and I haven't really, I'm not sure if it's true what I'm going to say, but I know that Jerry was filmed in Central Park, and at that time there was a lot of gay bashing, and I saw kind of a very courageous act of having a naked gay man running in Central Park yesterday in that film, and the running and the nakedness. I think, I don't know if consciously or unconsciously, he was making a references
right.
to that and proposing a free act.
Well, like, I don't know if that's what he was trying to
yeah,
do.
Yeah.
But certainly in New York during that period, and today in New York for that matter, to have a naked gay guy, through anywhere is a taking of a public space that's not considered legitimate. I mean, you get arrested, basically. So in that regard, that's why I see his early work as very much, particularly Jerobi, as a commentary on how do gay bodies can take space. And I say gay bodies, because gay was still not, the gay movement hadn't happened yet. Stonewall happened a few years later than Jerobi. So that's another interesting context of the films, how they, these films that were produced before the modern gay liberation movement were trying in various ways to produce a space of visibility for queer, but that was not a space of identity. And I think that's where the 60s differs from the 70s. When you start mobilizing people to demand certain things from the state and from institutions, there's a consolidation of identity that takes place that was not present in the queer underground. And that's why you have so many films of that period. For instance, you think about Jack Smith's Flaming Creatures, where everybody's grabbing everything. You're not really totally distinguishing what's a male body from a female body. And I also think that's why there's such a big centrality on drag during that period, as a commentary to the determinacy of sexuality and gender, and not too much interest in fixing those boundaries, which is actually what happens later. If you look at how drag queens, which were very important to visibility of gay culture in New York before 1969, become pretty much completely marginalized after 1969 by the emerging gay and lesbian movement because it's an embarrassment. You now have to be presentable because now you're sitting with Congress people, and now you're sitting with state officials and media officials. So the drag queens were an embarrassment to that kind of middle class idea of the new gay subject. Whereas in the earlier period, that was just not the case. The drag queen actually in some ways emblematized everything that they thought was interesting and productive. So. Yes.
Maybe you could explore a bit further how her suicide is liberating.
In Soltero's version, certainly. The way that, it's interesting that she definitely seems happier after the suicide as some kind of spiritual transcendence.
Mm-hmm.
So in that way, it's interesting that fame doesn't seem to do it. That fame is part of it, visibility, but it's somewhat toxic at the end, and then the death is not seen as the end of her, but maybe the beginning of her myth, which is another realm altogether. And the end sequence actually is one of the things, I don't know, those of you that saw it last night, that strikes me a lot about the film, is that Mario Montes doesn't act. He's just there. And that last sequence, I think it's kind of emblematizes that style of being in front of the camera, which is actually very different. And if you compare it to Trash, to Hollywoodland's major film with Warhol, another interesting contrast is that Mario Montes is not that verbal as Hollywoodland. I mean, Hollywoodland was prized by Warhol and other filmmakers because she could improvise a script. You just had to tell her, the welfare man is coming, and then she improvised everything else. verbally. It was very verbal. Mm-hmm. While Mario Montes has some verbal moments in the film, but fundamentally, it's an image that's created. Mm-hmm. That the word is actually sometimes not a central, it's not an anchoring presence to the construction of meaning in the work of Sortero as it is in the kind of second part of Warhol, when it's actually not Warhol anymore, it's more Paul Morrissey that's directing the film. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the whole thing is supposed to sink anyway, it follows that you're not. The whole thing is supposed to sink.
Yeah.
There's no attempt at all to try to sink it up. So.
Absolutely. So that's what I'm saying.
So but I'm saying that the verbal component seems to come after the fact, or be implied that it's coming after the fact. And it's not.
Right, so I'm saying that in Sortero, the audio, let's say, the verbal component is not designed to anchor the meaning of things. So it's not in sync. It's done after, while in a film like Trash, it's the verbal component is very, very important to making sense of what's going on. So I just say that it's a looser relationship between image and sound in the construction of meaning in Sortero's films.
I guess I'm saying that it's clear that they're not, whatever he's saying while we're filming, it's not at all
known.
I mean, it's totally divorced from it. It's not just that it's not
right.
Important, it's just totally not it.
Absolutely, yes. I agree. Yeah.
So you mentioned that the young lords had their 40th anniversary. Did you go to that?
Yes, I did.
Can you tell us about that, what that was like, or what happened, or who was there?
Yeah. Who was there? Many of the young lords were there, including not only New York lords, but also Chicago lords, Philadelphia lords, Newark lords, there were, branches, let's say, of the young lords in many cities, and each of them had a different characteristic. Like the Philadelphia young lords were Catholic young lords. I mean, many of them had links to the church, while the New York lords were college dropouts and the Chicago lords were gang members. So each city had a different configuration. So there were many of them, and then there was, I would say, the next two generations of New York Puerto Ricans in the arts and in politics, who in some ways have founded their activism based on their reading on the impact of the young lords. I think one thing that I found is that that there's certainly a crisis in the reproduction, though, of the idea of political avant-garde, in the sense that, and that event, I think, was emblematic of that, because you didn't see a new articulation of what the political avant-garde could be now, but rather a recognition of what the impact of the avant-garde was, from the 70s to today. So in that regard, it would be really difficult, maybe impossible, to have a new generation that would be like the young lords. One, because there's this idea that the avant-garde had of we articulate, we give you consciousness, and then you follow, which I think is something that's not very, that I don't know a lot of people into that idea anymore, buying into that idea. And of course, in the U.S. in particular, things have changed so much. And that's true also if you look at the kind of work that was being done by the queer avant-garde. If you take a truck in New York from a city truck to move it, you're going to get shot and you're going to die. And a lot of that has to do, of course, with the impact of 9/11 on the way that people view authority and view transgression of authority. So the climate is completely different. The very idea of the avant-garde as people lead, you follow, is, in crisis. So that's one of the glaring things about the event, that on the one hand, it was obvious that the young lords had a huge impact on the imagination of people for various generations, like decades of this. But on the other hand, the very way they went about things, there's nothing has really replaced it, but nobody is reproducing it either, which I think is probably true in many other places, that we all know something's not right, but how do you fix it? It's not clear at all. And what kind of the vocabularies that we had don't seem to quite work, but we don't have new vocabularies. So that's kind of, I would say, very typical of the moment that we are now. And that event, I think, made that very clear for me.
Francis, could you talk a bit about your film work and your writing work within the context of the building of this Puerto Rican identity struggle?
Yeah, well, let's see. I have spent about 15 years of my life, like most Puerto Rican intellectuals before this new generation, trying to save our country. I mean, you became an intellectual to save your country. That was the main reason. And by that, I mean that you critique colonialism, you try to maintain a certain idea of nationhood in the context of 100+ years of, colonial relations with the U.S. But, in my last book, the book before the one that's coming out, 2007 book, called None of the Above, I realized that Puerto Ricans didn't want to be saved. That they wanted to go shopping. The trigger for that book, which is called None of the Above, Puerto Ricans in the Global Era, was the culmination of three conferences that I organized after the 1998 plebiscite on status in Puerto Rico that yielded that out of five options, most people chose none of the above. And the other options were, you want to be a state of the U.S., you want to stay as you are, you want to be an associate republic of the U.S., you want to be independent, and the winning one was none of the above. So why does it mean that to me, right? And basically it meant that people were rejecting all the available ways of negotiating this relationship, because every one of those ways seemed to be unfair in some fundamental way, So becoming part of the United States was rejected because that people feared that that's going to mean a loss of culture, that Puerto Rican culture would in time disappear, that Puerto Ricans would only speak Spanish, and that would close down the Latin American identity of Puerto Ricans. Being independent is rotundly rejected. In fact, independence didn't get even 1% of the vote in that plebiscite because people view their relationship to the U.S. as a protective net against poverty, against unemployment, and not least the fact that there are more Puerto Ricans now living in the United States than in Puerto Rico. There's over 4 million Puerto Ricans in the U.S. and just under 4 million in Puerto Rico. So now, if you sever your relationship to Puerto Rico, to the United States in some way, you're actually creating big problems in the way that people can relate to each other, travel problems, family relation problems, and so forth. So I would say that right now my work is, I'm less invested in the kind of nationalist project that, and even if my project from the beginning was critical of nationalism, if you're still talking about it, you're still in some way constituted by it. It's like somebody told me that a recovering nationalist was like a recovering alcoholic, that you always had that problem, that you were never going to be totally free of it, I guess to some extent. But in the new work that I'm working on, like my next book is about sovereignty. It's called Sovereign Acts, and it's in conversation with Native Americans and other groups, Pacific Islanders, and seeing comparatively how the various communities that have been in some way colonized by the U.S. Come up with different ways of thinking about the problem by comparing our various situations. On my next project, my next two projects, one is about style, and that's partly the work I've done in the Young Lords, and it's a way of telling urban history through style and body movement and styling of bodies through the city. And the other project is a history of reggaeton, which is a music genre. And although both have something to do with Latinos and reggaeton, a lot to do with Puerto Ricans, it's not so much looking at it as symptomatic of the political problems of Puerto Rico as much as it is of looking at the particularity of it and not as an allegorical for something else. Which I think has been what Puerto Rican intellectuals have done for 100 years, which is everything is about the motherland, not about what it is. So I'm trying to look at what it is in other contexts that it's not about the assumption that somehow intellectual work can protect Puerto Rico from colonialism. And of course, Puerto Ricans don't read our work anyway. Tenure committees do. Anyway, and in film, my next film, the film that I'm finishing right now is about Guam, which is another territory of the U.S. in the Pacific. And it's about the experience and legacy of World War II in that territory. And of course, I got there because I was interested in the Spanish-American War that made us part of the U.S. But at the end, I realized how different they were from us, how different the World War II experience that they had made them different from us, and then try to understand that in its own terms. Like, you have a country that's deeply patriotic, pro-military, and then at the same time very critical of the military because of what happened there after the war. So, yeah.
In terms of the movement in the 60s, the movement like the Wars in New York, how what kind of an effect did that have in Puerto Rico? And so what is the political connection between I guess the States and Puerto Rico, and how does that, because for me this is a history lesson, because
right.
I didn't know a lot about the history, so I'm interested to know how you're saying there's more Puerto Ricans in the US than in Puerto Rico, and so it just seems like it's a really crazy idea to grasp.
Yeah.
So how, like, what is the
political? In a nutshell, the Young Lords at some point, their analysis of Puerto Rican oppression at some point led them to think that what they needed to do was to move to Puerto Rico and gain independence for Puerto Rico, and that would take care of the oppression of Puerto Ricans in the U.S. And they did that. I mean, they moved part of their operations to Puerto Rico, but what happened? Many things happened. One is that they were not Puerto Ricans, they were New Yorkers. So when they arrived, the established nationalist left pretty much told them, we don't need you. You know, you're not Puerto Rican and you should go back home. And that was a shattering experience. Although at the end, a good thing, because that rooted people more in New York, politically and culturally. And I think that at the end was not the worst thing that happened, but experientially at that moment, they had been fighting all their lives to claim their Puerto Ricanness, and then the Puerto Ricans telling them that they're not. And the second thing that happened was the FBI had kind of not messed with them too much while they were doing breakfast programs and they were challenging the city on issues of health. But the minute that they added Puerto Rico's independence to their priorities, then COINTELPRO got into the action and they started to be infiltrated by the FBI. That also led, and the combined issues of rejection in Puerto Rico, draining of resources brought there in a terrain that they were not familiar with, and the infiltration of the government ended up by, the organization imploded, basically. And fractured, and its effectiveness and its work pretty much ended. It's not, Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico, till to this day, despite the demographic reality, have not incorporated the U.S. Puerto Rican experience into their sense of Puerto Rican history. And the reason for that, one of the big ones, is that if you do that, then you have to accept a whole lot of other things that people there don't want to accept. Like, you have to accept, for instance, in Puerto Rico, language nationalism is very strong, that we don't speak English here, we speak Spanish, although the majority of people have some degree of bilingualism, but the official line is that we don't speak English here, that Puerto Ricans are defined by their language. But what happens when you have half of the Puerto Rican population whose native tongue or lingua franca is English? Complicates that idea of what a Puerto Rican is. What happens if you think of Puerto Rico as just the island, but in fact there's all these other Puerto Rican communities all over the country? That then complicates the centrality of Puerto Rico to determining who's a real Puerto Rican. So I would say that although some people know about the Young Lords and know about U.S. Puerto Rican history, it's not incorporated into the narrative, the national narrative there.